You see, this is great, but how is this going to appeal to my uncle who doesn't play video games? This doesn't answer my question. Yes, the Nintendo Switch has always been seen as kind of an amalgamation of everything Nintendo's ever done in one home console. I mean, that's something that they mentioned during the Nintendo Switch presentation 2017, how pretty much the Switch incorporates elements from every single one of their pieces of hardware prior. Hell, I think they even alluded to the fact that it's a home console to go, much like the GameCube. It had a handle. But once you experience this console, you understand exactly what they're getting at. You know, the Nintendo Switch pretty much allows for every type of Nintendo game you could possibly want to be playable on one system. Now, that doesn't mean everything, you know, it does lack stuff like cameras and a microphone, so you can't really play Nintendo DS games. You don't have like the 3D display of the 3DS, but by and large, with the power of the Joy-Con controllers, you can pretty much experience any type of Nintendo game you'd want on this. And what I mean by that is they pretty much double as standard video game controllers and Wii remotes. I mean, in the initial reveal trailer for the Nintendo Switch, the dude takes the two Joy-Con off and uses them kind of like Wii Remote and nunchucks, and this was before we even knew motion controls were a part of these things. But yeah, they revealed that, yes, these can be used as kind of Wii Remote replacements, which, you know what that means. Oh boy. It's easy to shit on Nintendo's casual video game efforts. They're not for me, I'm a gamer, can't you tell? But to be honest, like, I always find Nintendo's casual video game efforts to be pretty damn interesting. Sometimes I like them more than their more hardcore games. Not all the time, I feel like a lot of these fall pretty flat. However, some of their casual video games can have the most Nintendo-ass shit in them. Nintendo's always been one to think outside the box and just do stuff that nobody else is really doing. And they for sure did that with the Wii. It was all a part of Satoru Iwata's Blue Ocean strategy he was talking about. Whereas the PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360 initially were going for the pre-existing video game market, Nintendo wanted to broaden the appeal of video games, bring video games to a market that doesn't care about video games, because they knew they could show them why they should care about video games. Yep, the Wii appealed to the non-video game fans, or the casual gamers. And it was obviously a really smart move. I mean, like, you could criticize the hell out of it back then. I remember when we were in the Wii generation, Nintendo was getting flack left and right for making more casual-oriented games. A lot of people were criticizing them, going like, I don't want this garbage, I want insert game here that they didn't actually want. I feel like a lot of video game fans can't fathom the idea that some video games aren't meant for them, and when they see a video game company put out a video game not designed for them, they get weirdly upset about it. But hey, I'd argue because of Nintendo's direction with the Wii, we're in this place now where video games are the number one entertainment medium in the world. Like, it makes so much money and everybody plays video games. It's not really a weird thing anymore. Like, just everybody plays games. That's just how it is. That's not to say it was all sunshine and lollipops and chocolate and suckers and I could keep going on. Because that casual audience the Wii appealed to pretty much dropped it like a brick. They didn't care about it after, like, getting their fix in with Wii Sports and whatnot. So because of that, like, by the end of the Wii's life, people didn't give a damn about it anymore, which led to barely any momentum carrying them into the Wii U generation. Now, I think a lot of these casual gamers just moved on to stuff like mobile phone games and whatnot, but Nintendo did try to appeal to them a bit with the Wii U and the 3DS. We got a couple of games on those consoles like Wii Fit U, Wii Party U, Wii Sports Club, Brain Age Concentration Training on the 3DS, Crosswords Plus, the Art Academy games, but I'd say early on, maybe midway through that generation of Nintendo, I think they kind of realized most of the casual audience wasn't really on these platforms anymore. Most of the Wii U and 3DS audience were kids or core video game fans. So when I look at the library on those platforms, you know, that's what it mostly looks like. Genuine kids games and, like, the core Nintendo titles. However, with the Nintendo Switch, Nintendo came back with a vengeance for the casual audience. This was kind of a big deal, because at the Nintendo Switch presentation 2017, the first game that they showed off for the Nintendo Switch was the worst fucking game they could have possibly shown off. 1-2 Switch! Yep, this was pretty much the first official Switch game announced, outside of stuff like Breath of the Wild and like Dragon Quest XI was announced to be coming to the NX. This was the first thing officially fully confirmed. And yeah, this was pretty much positioned as like the Switch's Wii Sports / Nintendo Land. Though those games were pack-ins for the consoles for the most part, 1-2 Switch was not a pack-in. This was a game for everybody to enjoy that utilized the Joy-Con controllers as motion controls. And 1-2 Switch is always kind of seen as the biggest joke for Nintendo Switch, at least within the first year. This was a launch title right alongside Breath of the Wild. Guess which one I gave a fuck about. That's right, both, I bought both. 1-2 Switch retailed for $50 and is a party game for just everybody to enjoy. And you know, I'll be honest, the concept behind this game I don't think is like horrible. I think it's very interesting, and I will give 1-2 Switch this. It feels like there was like a genuine passion and idea behind this project. Hear me out. I absolutely love Nintendo Land for Wii U. I think that's one of the greatest multiplayer experiences of all time. Problem with that is, I don't really feel like Nintendo Land initiated development as anything more than, let's make the Wii U's version of Wii Sports. 1-2 Switch doesn't really feel like that. 1-2 Switch feels like the developers behind it said, let's utilize the Joy-Con controllers in very unique ways, where you're primarily using them while not looking at the display. Which kind of works with the Nintendo Switch's concept of like, hey, bring this wherever. For Nintendo Switch commercials, when people are playing 1-2 Switch, they usually put the system in tabletop mode, and it's just like, hey, you want to milk a cow? Let's just do it right here. So I'll give them that. You know, I think the concept is unique, and it feels like they genuinely had a different and new idea. That's about where the good things I have to say about 1-2 Switch end. This game is nothing, man. I mean, like what, like 28 something mini games, and none of them are like at all in depth. These are like WarioWare micro games in length. This is a game that entirely depends on the group you're playing it with. I remember playing this in college with my friends, and the first time we played it, you know, the Switch was brand new, we were dicking around, it was pretty fun. And then I tried playing with them a second time, and it wasn't fun anymore. It was like, all right, we get the concept. There's not much more to this. I don't know what else to do. And honestly, some of the minigames included don't even feel like they belong. And it's really lame, because the minigames that feel like they don't belong are the ones that actually utilize the Joy-Con in the coolest ways. The one thing everybody wants to talk about is the ball count minigame, where you're using the Joy-Con's HD rumble to try and figure out how many balls are supposed to be rumbling around in the controller. It's a wonderful application of the HD rumble. Why the fuck is it in 1-2 Switch? It doesn't fit with the rest of the games. There's like the mini game where you're unraveling a treasure chest, and you're like, you're looking at the screen for all of this. So it's just like, this doesn't make any sense. This doesn't correlate with the rest of the experiences that have like nothing to do with looking at the screen. The eating contest minigame is the only one that uses the IR sensor, and it's just like, okay, good for you, you did it. But it's like, I don't know, man. I mean, 1-2 Switch is kind of cute for like one time. This feels like a kind of game that you'd play during like a New Year's party with like your extended family, like aunts and uncles and cousins and stuff. Like the first time everybody experiences it, it's a blast. And then you try bringing it the next time you see everybody, and like, it's just not the same. I think I'm willing to give 1-2 Switch a bit more credit than a lot of other people. I don't think this would have been a good pack-in title, though. A lot of people claim this should be a pack-in title. I don't think this does a good job representing the Nintendo Switch. I think this does an interesting job utilizing the Joy-Con in unique enough ways, I guess. But like, this is a very odd use for the Nintendo Switch. This system that Nintendo is trying to push as a home console to go. Honestly, Breath of the Wild was the best possible launch title for the console, because it truly did show how amazing it was to play this incredibly massive home console game portably with no compromises. And then 1-2 Switch is just a bunch of random bullshit. I mean, when it comes to Nintendo's casual minigame collections that are available at the launch of their system, starting with the Wii, Wii Sports and Nintendo Land are in a completely different league from this game. But, you know, hey, I think this game can be fun, but only like once or twice. And yeah, after 1-2 Switch, Nintendo really didn't do a ton when it came to casual game releases on the Switch for a while there. They really focused on their core titles for 2017. You know, we had Mario Kart 8 Deluxe, Splatoon 2, ARMS, Pokken Tournament, Fire Emblem Warriors, Mario Odyssey, Xenoblade Chronicles 2. I mean, like, imagine grandma playing any of those. What the fuck is a Pokken Tournament, she proclaims. Honestly, I feel like that was an incredibly smart move. You know, really bringing the core fans for that first year. But that very next year, Nintendo had a bit of an announcement on their hands. Remember this? Yep, Nintendo Labo was announced very early on in 2018. And my God, this was like the most Nintendo announcement I had ever seen. That initial trailer for Labo was teased as like, hey, Nintendo's going to announce something. But it's not really meant for core gamers, you know? This is meant for everybody. And the way they showed this off genuinely felt magical. You know, this was kind of that quirky Nintendo magic that I love so much. Building accessories out of cardboard and then using them in video games was such a just out there concept. But it worked and it felt so Nintendo and it felt like this is like a legitimately really cool idea. The whole thing with Nintendo Labo was like, hey, like build your own accessory, and it kind of teaches you a little bit about engineering and just creativity and making your own thing, and then you can play with it and see how it all works. And then in addition, you can kind of make your own things in the Toy-Con garage mode in Labo. I loved everything about this until I actually played it. So I think Nintendo kind of pushed Nintendo Labo as a bit more of like a toy line, I guess, almost like it's like a Lego brand or something. So like Nintendo Labo Toy-Con 01, this is for the variety kit. And they also launched the robot kit the same day on April 20th, 2018. Haha. I believe this launched the same day as God of War on PS4. But everybody made their Wii jokes about Nintendo Labo instead. Cause haha, why are you buying cardboard for the Nintendo Switch? Cause I'm stoned! I love how like Nintendo Labo was so expensive and everybody made the joke and comment like, it's cardboard, why is it so expensive? It's just like, it's heavily engineered cardboard that you put together to then create these legitimate video game accessories. I probably took a lot of time and effort to create this cardboard in a way where it will then make these devices. I'm not trying to like defend Nintendo here, but like it's not like they were just selling us like a fucking box. It was a perforated box, damn it! Building the actual contraptions with Nintendo Labo was really damn fun. Now to be fair, I only really did the first one, and I can't really be compelled to do the rest of them. I do own the rest of them, so maybe someday, but you know, I don't see any point to it. Building these things was half the fun. And then when you could actually like play the video game portion, it was all incredibly shallow. Like there was nothing going on there. It was definitely cute. There were some cute things like this whole house mini game with the little creature you were playing around with. The motorcycle game, like, was a motorcycle game. The RC car was just kind of interesting. Like there wasn't really a game thing. It was more of like playing around with a toy. And that's the main thing. Like this is all kind of just a toy. And it's really satisfying and cool to be able to like make your own cardboard fishing rod and then being able to like actually use it with a video game and to feel like, wow, this feels like an actual fishing rod and I made this myself. Like it is really, really cool, but you can kind of see like they were right there. They could have made this like a legitimately awesome experience, but instead it's one where I'm like, yeah, this is cool, but I can't really recommend it unless you are like a kid who is genuinely interested in like engineering, because the video game portion, there's just nothing to it. And I only played the variety kit. I can't imagine what the robot kit was like, because like, okay, I got to make 5 contraptions and they got to make 1 with the robot kit. And the video game portion, while it is meatier than all of these, not by much. I think a lot of people looked at the robot kit for Nintendo Labo and said, oh, that's what Project Giant Robot became from the Wii U. And I'm not sure of that. I feel like it's almost kind of just a coincidence that they're both giant robot themed video games. But I don't know. I haven't done enough analysis of Project Giant Robot on Wii U compared to the robot kit for Nintendo Labo to say, oh, so that's what that became. Because Project Giant Robot was originally shown off for the Wii U at E3 2014, and then every year would go by, and it would always appear on Nintendo's upcoming games lineup, and they just had nothing ever to say about it. Until eventually they just said, yeah, we're not making the giant robot-ass game. But they did eventually make a giant robot-ass game for Nintendo Labo, and, I haven't played it, so I got nothing about the robot kit. I think it was like $10 more expensive than the variety kit. I'm just telling you, man, I think the variety kit was the way to go. A couple months later, Nintendo put out the vehicle kit, which, you know, you could make a steering wheel and everything, and I do think the video game portion of that was a bit meatier. And then you had the VR kit in 2019, which I did pick up that, which felt like the most obvious thing to do. You know, VR was really, in quotes, big at the time. Virtual reality is something where I think everybody has experienced at least like one virtual reality headset in their day, or they might have owned a cheap one here and there. Like, I've had like a Meta Quest 2 for a bit. I used it once. And I think that's how everybody is. Like, I don't think anybody actually uses virtual reality, but for some reason, video game companies like PlayStation keep investing in virtual reality projects, but then they don't make like a new Sly Cooper because they're like, oh, well, there's no market for that. Like, is there really a market for VR? But one of the cheapest forms of VR was that Google Cardboard thing you could buy where you just insert your phone into this cardboard cutout thing. Yeah, that's exactly what Nintendo did with Nintendo Labo. You could then use your Switch for VR, and it worked. But it was, like, not comfortable. The Switch's resolution was not high at all. There was no head strap, so you had to keep the Switch held up to your face. But the VR kit games themselves were pretty fun. And they offered a bit of a different purchasing method for the VR kit. Nintendo Labo was always criticized for its high price points, so they did offer like a starter kit for the VR headset and, you know, one of the Toy-Con contraptions. That was like $40, but I wanted to get like the full lineup. That was like something like $80 or $90 or something like that. And that one was like really hard to find. By the time the VR kit released, like Nintendo kind of gave up on Nintendo Labo. All in all, it did okay, but I think they were hoping this was gonna be like almost like Nintendo's version of Lego, I guess. And they did allow you to use some of the Nintendo Labo Toy-Con in other games. The most notable use was the VR kit, which is also why I think they wanted to make sure you could buy it kind of cheaper for like $40, because you could use it in Mario Odyssey and Breath of the Wild and Captain Toad in Smash Brothers. You can use a lot of the vehicle-based Toy-Con in Mario Kart 8 Deluxe. A little weird that they never incorporated the VR headset with Mario Kart 8. That feels like it would have made sense. And the VR support was always kind of weird in these games, where Mario Odyssey was kind of like, you're just viewing Mario from a distance and a fixed camera angle, and you just have to collect stuff. Breath of the Wild, the whole ass game is playable in VR, and like, my lord. It's definitely kind of cool because it's like playing the game in 3D, but oh, I don't know, man. Regardless, Nintendo Labo was kind of in that mid-range of a success. Like, all of the kits combined sold over 1 million units, but I think Nintendo wanted this to be a lot bigger, especially considering the trailer caused a lot of buzz. Everybody was like, wow, this is crazy. But in the end, it wasn't very practical. It was very expensive, and I feel like you kind of got the gist after just playing around with, like, one of these things. I respect the hell out of it, but I never want to play it again. Man, while I'd say Nintendo Labo definitely is more in the casual lineup of Nintendo's games, it's still kind of in its own weird little bubble. So overall, by like mid-2018, there really wasn't a ton of casual-focused Nintendo Switch titles from Nintendo themselves. Until Go Vacation! What the hell? This was like the weirdest thing in the world because Go Vacation was a game for the Wii by Bandai Namco. This was like the third game in the Wii Ski series. So you had Wii Ski and Snowboard, and then Go Vacation. Yeah, they just gave up on that whole ass title. Wasn't my favorite title, you know. Wii Ski just kind of felt like they were really pining to just make you think it was actually a part of the Wii series of games. It's kind of like Wii Love Golf on Wii. Like, what are you doing? What kind of a title is that? You just want to play ball with the big boys and be like, look at me, I'm a Wii series game too. F off. Now, Go Vacation, they actually tried to make this its own thing by ripping off Wii Sports Resort. I kid, because this is definitely a bit of its own thing. I don't think this is really a replacement for Wii Sports Resort. It's kind of just like, hey, this is a similar themed game, but it is very much its own thing. Actually, it has more of like a story mode focus to it, where you're running around this giant hub world and you're talking to people and you're accepting challenges and doing all these mini games. There are a lot of mini games in this, and they're all fairly okay. The problem is, I don't really think any of them are as fun as any of the Wii Sports Resort mini games. They're not nearly as addictive or entertaining, but they're not bad whatsoever. I think the structure of Go Vacation really does make it pretty fun. So it's not like this is Family Dollar version Wii Sports Resort. It is its own thing. And they ported it to Nintendo Switch for some goddamn reason. And Nintendo published it. Maybe because they were kind of like, hey, we got no major casual Nintendo Switch games ready to go right now. Let's work with Namco and let's just publish Go Vacation for the Switch. Because you can use your Miis in this game, so maybe this was kind of them throwing a bone to people who were like, I want a Wii Sports Resort type experience. It's just weird because this kind of started on the Wii as a Wii Sports ripoff, and then Nintendo published it themselves on the Switch. It's weird. You can still play with motion controls in this game, but you can also play just with flat out buttons. It just kind of makes a game like this feel really, really monotonous. Like, games like this really do need motion control to get a lot of enjoyment out of. When you're just playing a game like this with the Nintendo Switch Pro Controller, it just feels like, what the hell is the point here, man? But hey, guess what? It's compatible with the Joy-Con wheel. Oh, thank God. I was worried I wasn't gonna be able to use this. Decent game, but it kind of feels like Nintendo published it just to kind of fill a void in their lineup, you know? Like, this just feels strange as a Nintendo title. But you know what doesn't feel strange? Best goddamn casual game they've ever made. Look at it. Ring Fit Adventure, baby. This game is wild. This is, in my opinion, the perfect spiritual successor to the Wii Fit series. And Nintendo originally revealed this very similarly to Nintendo Labo, where they kind of announced it ahead of time, being like, we're cooking up a new casual experience for the Nintendo Switch. They were showing people just using the Ring Con, and they didn't show the gameplay. And then they revealed just the full game. And yeah, I just think this game is one of the best uses for the Nintendo Switch's hardware, with the Joy-Con specifically, and some of the greatest ideas to create just a fitness video game. Because listen, I really enjoy Wii Fit, but at the end of the day, when it comes to actually getting anything out of it, you really gotta push yourself with it, man. The things I really like about Wii Fit aren't necessarily making me break a sweat. It's like the soccer ball mini game where I'm balancing back and forth on the balance board. And it's just like, what am I really doing there? Like, am I really benefiting my health here? When it comes to the actual fitness portion of Wii Fit, I'm like, f that. The running was kind of cool. I like jogging in Wii Fit. But hey, Ring Fit Adventure actually incentivizes you to work out and puts it in an RPG. I feel like this is the perfect amalgamation of fitness and video game, where both elements actually enhance each other. And like, it just creates one of the most unique experiences. Honestly, Ring Fit Adventure, this is Nintendo at its finest. Does that mean I really wanna play it all the time? No, because this game kicks the shit out of me. It's genuinely hard, and honestly, like, I don't wanna go on the easier difficulties. I wanna look like that. Sexy fit Dragon Man. I kinda like to go on the harder difficulties, and like, yeah, it makes it so then when I've played Ring Fit Adventure, I don't play it for long, but even just talking about it now, I do genuinely kind of want to go back to it. I do want to try it out some more because it is very fun, it is very cool, and it is a good workout. And it's a legitimate adventure game with just a huge amount of content. You know, it really incentivizes you to keep going. You get that sense of progression. And then you also have some cool mini games to play with the Ring Con. You have this whole ass rhythm mode they added to it. I mean, it took a while, but we finally got a casual game made by Nintendo on Nintendo Switch that I think is truly worth a damn. But who the hell needs it? Fitness Boxing 1 and 2. I believe Fitness Boxing 1 released in early 2019, while Fitness Boxing 2 released in late 2020. And I'd say if you want to work out with your Nintendo Switch, but you don't want to pay like the 70, 80 bucks for Ring Fit Adventure, I mean, these are pretty good. You can definitely crack a sweat with these. Once again, the fact these are published by Nintendo is really strange because these are kind of the successors to a Wii game called Gold's Gym Cardio Workout. And I gotta say, the concept behind this does make you kind of break a sweat where, you know, it's all about boxing to the beat of a song. Hey, it does kind of make you tired. But Nintendo publishing this felt like, again, at the time, they were kind of like, okay, well, we haven't put out our own fitness games yet, so let's put these out because these kind of fit our vibe for what casual titles are. You know, these do kind of feel like Nintendo games. Much like how to some people, Go Vacation feels like a Nintendo game. And in fact, they technically are Nintendo games because Nintendo published them. But they aren't developed by them, and Fitness Boxing 1 and 2 are pretty good for what they are, but I don't really think they're anything special. Most interesting thing about this series is how they just eventually started doing these collaborations like the Fist of the North Star version or the Hatsune Miku version. Let's see Brain Age do that. So here we have Dr. Kawashima's Brain Training for Nintendo Switch. This launched in like late 2019 in Japan and like early 2020 in Europe. And it didn't release in North America, which is kind of hard to understand why. North America has banned the concept of video games saying they can like train your brain, I guess. Because like, you know, these games aren't really actually like making your brain bigger or like making you smarter. So I guess they were like, oh, that's false advertising. But it's kind of strange because like, yeah, the European title has always been Brain Training. Over here, it's always been Brain Age, which I don't really think fits that criteria for like being misleading. And at that point, they could just like get rid of any taglines or any misleading advertising and just, you know, advertise it as, hey, here's an edutainment game. I don't know. But regardless, they never put this out in North America. It's just kind of strange. I really wish they would have because it's fine. I do like the Brain Age games, but you know, when you actually play them, after getting like 5 minutes in, you've pretty much seen everything they gotta throw at you. There are some cool exercises in this game, but it does feel like a step back from the 3DS entry. That felt like it was genuinely kind of building upon the DS games. This just feels like it's just Brain Age from the DS, but on the Switch. You definitely have some interesting additions like multiplayer. You know, you have two Joy-Con and you know, you can battle off against somebody else. You also use the IR camera on the Joy-Con to do, you know, rock, paper, scissors. And you also get a stylus in here to do the, you know, iconic math problems from Brain Age. So, this is a Brain Age game, by all means. But I kind of feel like this game on Nintendo Switch said more about how Nintendo is obviously bringing together their handheld and home console games on one system for the Nintendo Switch, more than it said anything else. It was like, here's a franchise that's only ever been on DS and 3DS, and hey, here's the Nintendo Switch version. So that was really cool. And that's all I have to say about it. I genuinely have nothing else to say about it. Once again, like, Brain Age is fine, but there's really not a lot going on to really talk about it like an actual video game. And even as far as Brain Age games go, there's not a lot to say about this one in particular. The most interesting thing about it is the fact that we never got it in Ohio. But thank God. they weren't complete cowards. We got it! Clubhouse Games 51 Worldwide Classics, resurrecting a pretty dead IP from the DS, Clubhouse Games. And this kind of feels like Nintendo wanted to do a couple of things here. You know, they wanted to bring back the Clubhouse Games IP, sure, but they also wanted to kind of have a bit of an all-in-one casual game collection. Not only do you get a lot of the stuff from the original Clubhouse Games when it comes to a lot of tabletop stuff, card games, but you also get a lot of games reminiscent of ones you'd find in Wii Sports and Wii Play. When you have bowling, shooting gallery, tanks. This kind of felt like Nintendo wanted to bring back the Wii series without bringing back the Wii series. I feel like they were a little confused on which direction to go with that franchise. You base an entire series name off of the console it originated on. Do you still call it Wii Sports on Switch, or do you call it something else? Let's just bring back Clubhouse Games and we'll put bowling in there. Hey, I'm not complaining. I love this game. Is it the most exciting, incredible experience known to man? No, but it does what it does well, damn it. It's exactly as advertised. It's 51 tabletop games, or just Clubhouse Games, or just fun little casual games you can play at a moment's notice. It's genuinely a blast. The graphics look fantastic for what it is. Like, they have so much fine detail in this game. I love even the sound design, just hearing the little plops and clanks of your little pieces. And stuff like Shooting Gallery is kind of a cool little tribute to Wii Play. It isn't the Wii Play game in its entirety, but you can't tell me it wasn't inspired by it. Bowling is pretty good. I don't think it's perfect, but I think it is pretty all right. But that's not even what this game does best. I do think this game really does succeed at just basic, simple, easy pickup to play little party games. It's so easy to crack this out and play a little bit of billiards where it's kind of like 8-ball pool on the iPhone, or like dots and boxes, Mancala, Ludo. It's just, it all works so damn well in this game. It is such a simple game, but that's what I love about it. Clubhouse Games is honestly like probably in my top 20 favorite Nintendo Switch games. Might even be top 15. Maybe top 10, fuck it. I mean, like, I'm just talking out of my ass at this point. Top 3. It's the perfect casual party game. I think it belongs in everybody's collection. I think everybody can get something out of this experience. You have online play, you have local multiplayer. There is some weirdness here with the fact that, like, a game like bowling doesn't have 4-player multiplayer, which doesn't make any sense because that game, you take turns anyway, so, like, what gives? But damn it, I'm willing to look past that because Clubhouse Games, 51 Worldwide Classics, it's exactly what it says. There's 51 Worldwide Classics. Oh, well, fuck it. There's actually 52, so fuck this game. They scammed me. Much like Big Brain Academy, Brain versus Brain. Fuck you. Okay, I don't think this game is bad or anything, but like, I was so disappointed by this. This came out in 2021, and when this was announced, I was pretty jazzed, all right? Big Brain Academy on the Wii degree, is great. It's mainly great for its multiplayer. I think the multiplayer mode in that game is so damn fun. It's a genuine mode, you know? You play fighting against a friend, and, you know, it feels like a mode you'd find in, like, a Mario Party game, you know? It probably lasts, like, 20 to 30 minutes, and you're just kind of powering through it, trying to see who has the biggest brain. And the fact that this game was announced with a subtitle like Brain versus Brain, I was like, hot damn, we're going all in on the multiplayer. And the multiplayer mode in this game is one of the most pathetic fucking things I've ever seen in my life. It's just, it's so nothing. It literally lasts 5 minutes. It's like, oh yeah, you want to play against a friend? Here, play for 5 minutes. Oh, you won. Okay, moving on. There's nothing to it. It's so damn basic. And the rest of the game, like so much of the content in this game, is like the exact same as the Wii game, the exact same as the DS game. And I'm just like, what are we doing here? What is the point? I'm almost kind of questioning, like, why was this game okay to release in North America, but you couldn't get Brain Age out here? They're both big brain games. Oh, brain to chest, test your brain, flex your brain. I don't know. I will say this game does succeed where it comes to the Ghost Online multiplayer. That's what Brain versus Brain is primarily talking about here. You can go online and play against other people's ghosts and then see who has, you know, the biggest brain there. And that all works pretty okay. And I think kind of going through the single player and just trying to get, you know, the best score possible, getting your medals and everything, like, that was pretty fun. but it's very short-lived. To be fair, Big Brain Academy Brain vs. Brain was only $30 at launch. So, like, they knew this was a smaller title, and for what it is, it does exactly what you'd think it would do. But I'm just kind of like, what? There's not really anything new that we haven't seen from Big Brain Academy before this. Like, I'm just like, is it really that hard to come up with new Big Brain Academy minigames or brain teasers or anything like that? It was just kind of shocking to me how little content this game had. It felt like it was just the Wii game again, but a step back. But hey, we have online multiplayer functionality, so whoop-de-doo, see, that's how you get your replay value. I feel like that's kind of like a weird thing Nintendo does, where a lot of their games lack a ton of content, but they include online multiplayer, so they think, oh, well, that's where all of your replay value will go. So we don't have to make a ton of content because you're definitely just gonna play the online multiplayer over and over and over and over again. That's what they do with like the Mario Sports games, and that's what they're gonna do with the next game we'll talk about. Oh man, the bastards did it! Nintendo Switch Sports. Yeah, after looking at all of their casual game efforts on Switch thus far, felt like Nintendo was just constantly trying to push the boundary to just see how much they could do not Wii Sports while also trying to do Wii Sports. You know, like incorporating a lot of those mini games and clubhouse games, publishing Go Vacation, or doing fitness boxing instead of like a Wii Fit follow-up. Eventually, by 2022, they said, fuck it. Here's Nintendo Switch Sports. It's literally just Wii Sports, but for the Nintendo Switch. And my God, I mean, they kind of fucked it up. They didn't fuck it up entirely, but they kind of fucked it up. Sales-wise implies they didn't really fuck it up. I mean, this game sold incredibly well, and I'm very happy to see that it sold incredibly well, but I'm also a little upset that it sold incredibly well, because this feels like a full-blown reboot for the Wii Sports franchise. This doesn't feel like a direct follow-up to Wii Sports Resort or even Wii Sports Club. It feels like, hey, let's just start a new brand, Nintendo Switch Sports, with these little gremlins. Yes, you can use your Mii in this game, but that's not what they want you to use. They want you to use these Sportsmates looking things. They're horrible. I don't think they're badly designed characters. I think they're badly designed avatars. They all look the same. There's only a couple of different hairstyles you see them all have. Like, all the dudes have this same haircut. And you have to unlock the rest of the customization by playing the online multiplayer over and over and over again. And I'm just like, this is dumb. I'm sorry. It's just, I hate the customizable characters in this game. Again, I don't think they look bad by themselves, but like as a representation of you in the game, they're horrible. The Miis are so much better. I think the Miis are like the greatest custom character out there because they're so simple, but everybody can make a Mii that looks like them. I don't think you can do that with the Sportsmates, or unless without grinding your ass away in online multiplayer matches. And that's all this game has. It's online multiplayer. That's the only thing you can do in this game. It's just pretty much just keep playing online. That's it. You can play offline, you know, don't worry about that, but why would you when you can play online? And that's where all your progression lies. There's nothing you can do offline other than just play the game once and then boom, okay, good for you. The sports themselves function well and they're all pretty fun. I think the control is pretty solid. Bowling works great. It feels as bowling should. Nintendo completely nailed the feel of bowling in Wii Sports and Wii Sports Resort. So, like, I was very picky on how it should feel in Nintendo Switch Sports, and they did a good job with it. Same goes with tennis and chambra, which was sword fighting in Wii Sports Resort. But they include, like, badminton, which I'm like, what the hell is the point of this? Like, this should be, like, an alternate option when you select tennis on the menu. It shouldn't be its own sport in the game. Volleyball, which is at least, you know, more unique, but at the same time, the court is, you know, a bit similar to tennis, so a lot of these sports end up feeling the same. And then soccer, which is, again, fun, but it kind of boils down to, it feels like a slower on foot version of Rocket League, And at that point, it doesn't feel like a Wii Sports game. I can't imagine my mom understanding how to play soccer in Nintendo Switch Sports. They've added more sports via free updates like golf and basketball. And, you know, that's cool. You know, it's all free. But, you know, I think that implies they feel a little bad. They're like, ah, shit, we really owe these people. We really sold them this game for like $50. They included this leg strap, which was included in Ring Fit Adventure. And it's literally just for the soccer mode, but they had to do a free update to allow you to use the leg strap in full-blown soccer matches. The only thing you could use the leg strap for at launch was like this shootout minigame. So I'm just kind of wondering, like, what the hell? This game had this giant box with the leg strap included. I didn't even need a leg strap. This was designed for Ring Fit Adventure, but they just threw it in here for no reason. I feel like they just wanted this to have like a big presence on retail. Pretty much most Wii Sports games have been like bundles of some sort. Like Wii Sports was included with the Wii, Wii Motion Plus was included with Wii Sports Resort. So they were like, oh man, well we need to include something with Switch Sports. Let's just throw in an extra leg strap. It. The casuals are dumb. They'll think that's cool. I think it's really easy to get heated up about Nintendo Switch Sports, and rightfully so in many cases. Though I do have to admit, this game is well made. It is pretty fun. I like that it has online multiplayer. I think it does look nice. I think it controls nice. But there are a lot of things about this game that I think kind of failed to meet my expectations for what a Wii Sports successor on Switch should be. Now, with the free updates, you know, looking at the game, I think it's fair to be like, all right, okay, things have shaped up a little better. But at the same time, it doesn't really feel like the developers really wanted to make this. Kind of more so Nintendo wanted to see if they could capture that Wii Sports magic again on Switch, so they were like, make Nintendo Switch Sports. Like I was saying, 1-2 Switch, you can criticize that game to hell and back. This is definitely way better than 1-2 Switch, but you got to admit, 1-2 Switch feels like they had an idea for that. So fuck it, I'll just say it. Nintendo Switch Sports is okay, but I do respect 1-2 Switch more. Damn it. Yeah, Nintendo did a sequel to 1-2 Switch. Everybody 1-2 Switch. This game was rumored about before even Nintendo Switch Sports was revealed. I remember when they announced Nintendo Switch Sports, the little animation they did in the Nintendo Direct, I thought it was gonna lead into a 1-2 Switch sequel, but I was pleasantly surprised when it turned out to be, you know, oh yeah, this is the actual casual game I want. Especially considering when everybody 1-2 Switch was being rumored about, it was being rumored about that it was god fucking awful. Nintendo playtested it and nobody liked it. Nintendo internally was like, this is the worst game that we've ever made. This definitely felt like it was a product of Nintendo looking at the sales numbers for 1-2 Switch and going, oh, well, we surely should make a sequel to that, without really realizing everybody who bought that just bought it because it was a launch title, and what the fuck else were you gonna buy? Made me feel bad because, like, Super Bomberman R was kind of the same way, and they made Super Bomberman R 2, and I don't think anybody bought that game. A lot of people bought Bomberman R 1 because it was a launch title, and then R 2 came out, and like, yeah, I still don't think people know that game exists. This one, I don't feel nearly as bad about. They launched this one for $30, which was definitely a lot cheaper than 1-2 Switch's original $50 price. But I gotta be honest, everybody 1-2 Switch, it's really confusing. There's not as many mini games in this one, and instead there's a lot more like filler. There's a lot more like variations of games to play in here, and they also allow you to use like your smart devices to do kind of like a Jackbox party pack setup, where oh, people can use their smartphones and connect to the same device, and then you know, we can do quiz shows and we can do little mini games where, you know, you're running around the room and trying to find something that matches this particular color. Like, it has some of the same energy as the original 1-2 Switch, where you can look at some games and say, that's kind of a cute idea. And 1-2 Switch was more of like a two-player game. You could play with four players in like the team mode, but like, this is primarily meant for a lot of people. Like, they're going like, oh, you can play with 100 people. I don't know what situation you do that at, maybe like at a damn wedding? But yeah, this just feels like a wildly misguided experience. again, very similar to the original 1-2 Switch. I feel like if you're playing with the right group of people, you can have kind of a stupid fun time with this. And the $30 price tag definitely helps out there, because it's a little more like, yeah, I could imagine picking this up and just being like, get a little drunk and you're gonna have a blast. But similar to 1-2 Switch, after you play once, there is nothing. There is nothing left for you here. It's hard to explain this game. Like, at least with the original 1-2 Switch, I could at least understand the ethos of what they were doing with it. This one just feels even more like just a bunch of random bullshit. With that being said, I don't think this is the worst thing ever. I don't think this is like an abomination. I think in many regards, you could consider this to be better than the original 1-2 Switch, but keep in mind, that isn't a compliment. Whew, man, I mean, we can also talk about Endless Ocean Luminous because, you know, I'd say this kind of does classify as a casual game. I mean, it definitely isn't much of a traditional one. And the original Endless Ocean games were like in the Touch Generations lineup, I believe in Europe, back on the Wii. And the Touch Generations lineup was meant to be like, oh, this is meant for everybody, for casual audiences. And Endless Ocean, I respect the hell out of this. And it does definitely fall in line with like why I think Nintendo is so interesting, because this is a game Nintendo's like, yeah, we're publishing this and we believe in this game. They really shouldn't have, because like Endless Ocean Luminous isn't very good, but still, this is a game that I don't think Sony would give a shit about. Microsoft wouldn't really give a shit about, but Nintendo sees value in it because this is a very unique experience. It's a scuba diving game where you're just exploring the ocean. There's nothing else really like this in modern gaming, and I think that's really, really cool. And the fact that we're willing to bring back like this dead Wii franchise that we haven't seen a new entry from in like 15 or so years, like that is awesome. The problem is Endless Ocean Luminous was obviously made on a pretty strict budget. Even if the budget was similar to the original Wii games, I think being in HD kind of shows the flaws a little more here. In addition, like, there's no true voice acting. They have like an AI text bot explaining things to you. Everything just feels like they wanted to make the most out of the little that's actually in this game, because the entire ocean floor is procedurally generated, and I'm sorry, it's boring as hell. I want this to actually be designed by a video game designer. Knowing that this is procedurally generated, I just feel like I'm exploring the most boring ocean floor of all time. The Wii games actually felt like there was some form of discovery here. Technically speaking, yes, I am discovering something when it's like, oh, this is like a completely original sea floor, but like it's not interesting to me. I'm sorry. I don't think this game is worthless, but I do think it is not very entertaining to me personally. And that's not to say I wouldn't find an Endless Ocean game entertaining. I played a bit of the Wii games, and I do kind of like them. I'm like, yeah, this is very interesting and very soothing and relaxing. Endless Ocean Luminous is just boring. And I feel like the procedurally generated thing they were trying to spin as like, oh my god, this game has so much, an endless amount of content, because, oh my god, it changes every time. It's truly an endless ocean. But in reality, it makes me just not care about exploring the ocean here. And you know what? Endless Ocean Luminous kind of represents a lot of the problems that I have with most of Nintendo's casual output on Switch. A lot of the games that they put out feel like they really lack in content and passion. They feel a little directionless, and they feel like they're just trying to recapture some of the magic of how big these types of games were during the Wii and DS generation. Especially considering a lot of people grew up with those games, and now they're old enough to be nostalgic over it. So it's like, yeah, it's really cool to see Endless Ocean back. It's really cool to see Big Brain Academy back. But they lack so much in terms of sheer content. And it doesn't really feel like it would be that difficult or that crazy to put in more content. It feels like they're really penny pinching with some of these games. Like, why aren't there more variations of Brain Teasers in Big Brain Academy? Why did Nintendo Switch Sports launch with barely any more sports than the original Wii Sports? But damn, I gotta say, when Nintendo hits it out of the park with their casual games for the Switch, they hit it out of the park with stuff like Ring Fit Adventure, Clubhouse
games.
I'd say the Nintendo Switch era has had some incredibly high highs and incredibly low lows when it comes to Nintendo's published casual Switch games. But hey, just the fact that they're still willing to support this kind of stuff, and they do understand that there is an audience for this stuff. I mean, I'm genuinely really interested to see whenever Nintendo has a game franchise come out that may not be immediately directed towards the core gamer. Because I honestly feel like what the core gamer says they want is generally pretty boring. It's like, I just want a new Zelda game that plays like the Zelda games that have played like the Zelda games for 20 plus years. I want a Mario game that looks just like the Mario game I grew up with 20 years ago that looks like every other Mario game. Endless Ocean Luminous, it may not be for you, it may not be for me, but damn it, it's interesting. And I think this is what video games are all about. The fact that you can genuinely make a video game about anything, and Nintendo is a publisher that is willing to take a chance on shit like this. That is awesome. Not Endless Ocean Luminous, though. That isn't awesome. I don't like this game.